Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon. My name is Cécile Froment, and I teach here in the Art History Department. So on behalf of the Center for International Studies and of the Committee on African Studies, I would like to welcome you to this academic year's first African Studies Distinguished Lecture. This lecture series, established in 2011, brings one speaker to campus each quarter whose work and scholarship showcase the cutting edge in the field of African studies. Today, we are more than delighted to welcome Mariana Candido, assistant professor in the History Department at Princeton University. Dr. Candido received her BA in History from the Universidade Federal do Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, her master's in African studies from El Colegio de Mexico, and her PhD in African history from York University in Canada. Dr. Candido is not only international in her training, but also in her scholarship, having published widely in a range of languages. And I hope that my less than impressive pronunciation and French accent in English, Spanish, and Portuguese will not obscure her more than impressive publication record. Dr. Candido is the author of two books, the first one published in 2001 in Mexico, titled Fronteras de Esclavización, Esclavitud, Comercio e Identidad en Benguela, 1780 a 1850, or Enslaving Frontiers, Slavery, Trade, and Identity in Benguela, 1780-1850. And her second book, An African Slaving Port on the in the Atlantic World, Benguela and Its Hinterland, will come out early next year with Cambridge University Press. In addition, her many essays have appeared in journals such as Slavery and Abolition, Brésil, Sciences Humaines and Sociales, thankfully something in French, Afro-Asia, and the Luso-Brazilian Review. Our talk today is titled Reexamining the Marginal Institution, the Role of Benguela, Angola in the Transatlantic Slave Trade. I do hope that you will all join us after the presentation for a small reception in the tea room upstairs. But in the meantime, please help me in welcoming Mariana Candido.
Let me deal with this setup. Well, thank you all. First of all, I have to thank Cécile Froment, Jean Clason, and Rachel Jean-Baptiste for inviting me and organizing this lovely trip to Chicago. It's always nice to be here. And I also have to thank you all for coming and attending my talk today. So my talk today is an effort to re-examine the slave trade in the South Atlantic. The slave trade in the South Atlantic has been described as a marginal institution in a famous article by Joseph Miller in 1991, and this idea has been repeated in his latest book just published, The Problem of Slavery as History. Miller's conception of marginal is central to his understanding of the history of the slave trade and its effect on African societies. Even though Miller claims that slavery was a marginal institution, the latest estimates on the volume of the transatlantic slave trade rank Benguela as the third most important port of the coast of Africa. Only Luanda and Ouidah have seen more people exported from their shores than the people in Benguela. So I start my talk asking, how can we say an institution is marginal when more than 700,000 people have been deported? Or even more, how can we say that an institution is marginal when it provoked major political, economic, and social changes in a region? Moreover, another famous specialist of West Central Africa have claimed that Benguela is not important or was in the periphery of the Atlantic world in the 17th century. A point that I will come back later in my talk. So my goal today is to bring Benguela to the forefront of the debate and to remove it from its periphery or as a place marginal in the Atlantic world. My talk today is based on my upcoming book called An African Slave Import in the Atlantic World, Benguela and its Hinterland, hopefully to be published very soon. And this book traces the history of Benguela from its foundation as a Portuguese colony in the beginning of the 17th century to the mid-19th century when slave sports came to an end, but not slavery. This is going to be the first book in English on the history of Benguela, on the port of Benguela, and it's also an addition in the literature in Portuguese since the latest book on the history of Benguela was published in 1946. And the scholar who wrote it was Ralph Delgado, a colonial historian who defended, among many other things, colonialism and the role of the Portuguese in the region, reflecting the moment when the book was written and published. By then, by the 1940s, Angola was still under colonial rule, and Delgado's contribution were very much sympathetic to colonialism and to European dominance over African societies. Despite the importance of Benguela as the third largest slave port in the coast of Africa, most of the scholarship on the transatlantic slave trade and on slavery in the African continent has focused on regions north of the equator and in West Africa, places that I'm sure you are familiar with, such as the port, such as Gorée, or the ports in the Bight of Benin and the Bight of Biafra, or even in the Gold Coast. So what I'm doing here is bringing the debate on the transatlantic slave trade into the South Atlantic, as other scholars have done before me, such as John Thornton, José Curto, Roquinaldo Ferreira, among others. In the end, most of the slaves exported from the African continent left from West Central Africa, where roughly Angola is, and most of the slaves who arrived in the Americas, most of the African slaves who arrived in the Americas arrived in a single location in what is nowadays Brazil. So the transatlantic slave trade was a South Atlantic business, and I will try to convince you that it was not a marginal one in West Central Africa. So in this map, and I hope the map is clear, and let me see if I manage to. Okay. Here's Benguela. As you can see, Benguela is situated on the central coast of present-day Angola, and an indigenous settlement existed there before the Portuguese arrived in 1617. From the early 17th century to 1975, Benguela was a Portuguese colony, sometimes autonomous from the central administration in Luanda, but most of the time under Luanda's control. Today, Benguela is the fourth largest city in Angola, and it has an important fishing industry. Yet, Benguela was a relatively small town in the period that I'm focusing on, so from the 17th century to the mid-19th century, never exceeding 3,000 inhabitants. Despite its size, Benguela is a great way, or I believe Benguela is a great way, to understand the impact of the transatlantic slave trade in Africa and the importance of incorporating research on the African diaspora to understand changes that took place in the African continent before the 20th century. Benguela is also a great case to discuss how to write the history of Africa before the 20th century. Like regions that had contacts with the Muslim world and produced written documents in Arabic, there are many written documents available in the history of this region. Some of these sources are located in archives in Angola, others in Portuguese, but many are also available in Brazil. This image you see here is the typical colonial document produced in the 17th century. It's an official correspondence, correspondence exchanged between the Portuguese authority in Benguela and the Portuguese base in Lisbon. And it discusses matters of the need for more military people in Benguela. This document is from the... Hope you'll go back. So this document is from the Arquivo Histórico Ultramarino in Lisbon, in Portugal. This one is a similar kind of document, but it's not a loose letter. As you saw in the previous one, this is a bounded volume copying the letters exchanged between authorities in West Central Africa and authorities in Portugal. And this is from the National Archive of Angola, located in Luanda. This is one of the documents that I use extensively in my research, and I will talk a little bit more about this kind of documents. These are parish records. This is a baptism record. It's from the end of the 18th century, and it's from a place very special in my research. You will see some pictures later on, a place called Kakonda, located 200 miles inland of Benguela. And it gives a sense of the people being baptized there by the end of the 18th century. It's the kind of document where you can find, the official documents, you find lots of information on colonial officers, African rulers, but in this kind of documents you find information about slaves, women, and people who tend not to be present in the official documents. But surprising, there are also important documents related to Benguela history located in Brazil. And this one is from the Instituto Histórico Geográfico Brasileiro. It's an archive, is a library and an archive located in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. It's a document, it's a copy of orders from the governor to the governor of Benguela in the end of the 18th century, instructing him on how to deal with with African authorities and how exactly to sign treaties with them. So as you can see, documents related to Benguela history are located in different parts of the Atlantic world. And this is an image of Benguela in the mid-19th century. As you can see, it's a very small place with very few houses and a church, or two churches. A point I want to share with you in this talk is the fact that the Atlantic commerce transformed society in Benguela in its interior. The historiography of West Central Africa downplayed the effect of the transatlantic slave trade, and I'm going in a different direction. In my upcoming book and in this talk, I show how the expansion of slave exports shift the trade routes, affected agricultural production and the local diet, and favored the spread of slave raids, as well as led to the collapse of old states and emergence of new ones. People migrated from the coast into the interior, relocating from the pressures of the Atlantic economy. I see political and social changes happening continuously in the 17th, 18th, and 19th century. But my fellow colleagues who work on West Central Africa have emphasized continuity and stability. John Thornton, for example, has claimed that there was no demographic decline in West Central Africa because women managed to reproduce fast enough to recuperate the loss of young and healthy people deported to the Americas. Joseph Miller has argued that diseases, famine, and droughts had a more profound effect in this region than raids and warfare associated with the slave trade. In this study and in this talk, I demonstrate how the involvement of local political and merchant elites in the Atlantic economy led to a series of radical transformations in settlement patterns, political systems, and identities in the hinterland. I will not be able to talk about all of this today, so you have to believe me that I will be able to, that I'm able to prove that, and if you're curious, you can always read the book. But I will show you some examples. This is an image of the coast of Benguela, and what I want to emphasize here is that this was not empty land before the Portuguese arrived. The largest group who lived in this region was the Ndombe, or Mundombe in Portuguese sources, who were organized under different chiefdoms along the Caro Bay, or the Bahia das Vacas, as the Portuguese call, due to the large number of cows they saw here. The Ndombe did not constitute a homogeneous group unified under a single authority. They were agropastoralists, they fished, they hunted small birds and animals, and they traded with groups located inland. The arrival of the Portuguese was probably seen as part of normal movement of traders in this region. The ruler of the chiefdom of Peringue, the ruler of this region of Benguela, granted the Portuguese the right to settle after receiving payment of tribute. Initially seen as a commercial partnership, he did not expect the new arrivals to settle for the long term. Yet the Portuguese had already established merchant communities along the coast of West Africa, including the fortress of Elmina, and they expected to do the same in West Central Africa. They had failed in the Congo Kingdom, but they were successful along the coast of the state of Angola, where Luanda is currently located. So what we see here is that while Peringue expected a short-term visit, the Portuguese intended to settle and establish a Portuguese colony. The local population resisted territorial occupation, but eventually autonomous chiefdoms enter in contact with the small Portuguese army. Most of the contact was Pacific in the early 17th century and based on the exchange of trade goods. But by the mid-17th century, episodes of armed conflict shaped the interaction between the two groups, between the Ndombe and the Portuguese. While some rulers managed to remain outside of the influence of the Portuguese colony, others signed vassalage treaties that guarantee easy access to firearms, cannons, and gunpowder. Similar to what had happened in the New World, where Spaniards were seen as allies by minor rulers against the Aztec expansion, rulers of smaller West Central African communities welcomed Portuguese support against stronger neighbors. The alliance proved to be fatal and represented the end of autonomous political life for some rulers. But we know this because we are looking from now back to the present. People did not know at that point. Treaties with the Portuguese required the payment of tributes, in most cases in the form of slaves. Rulers were also forced to open their territories to traders and their caravans and to welcome Catholic priests and colonial authorities. In exchange, they had access to imported commodities. Portuguese expansion imposed a language of right and distinguished the local population between those who are allies or enemies, Christians and non-Christians, vassals and no vassals of the Portuguese crown. And vassals could not be sold as slaves since they were Christians and subject to the Portuguese crown. As a subject, they were protected by Portuguese legislation. I will not be able to enter in details on this, but I can tell you that there were several cases of Ndombe and other groups who had signed vassalage treaties with the Portuguese and later on were able to present their case to colonial judges claiming to have been illegally enslaved. In some cases, freedom was restored. But what is interesting about this case is how both parties, the Portuguese and local population, seem to agree that slavery was legal and that some people could be protected from the institutions and some people could be protected from slavery, implying that there were people who could be enslaved. In the short term, vassalage treaties might have resulted in the survival of local political elites. In the long term, however, treaties with the Portuguese allowed the expansion of colonialism, brought dependence on important commodities such as alcohol, gunpowder, and textile, and lead to the imposition of new elites who relied on their strong ties to the Atlantic commerce. The violence that was required to generate captives of war that fed the expanding need for cheap labor in the mines and plantations of the New World provoked political instability, displaced people who became refugees, and affected food production in West Central Africa. Although political competition and warfare predated the arrival of the Portuguese, the high level of violence was previously unknown. And once introduced, it lasted more than 300 years. The continuous disruption of raids, warfare, and other acts of violence forced the Ndombe and neighboring groups to restructure the institutions that organized their lives. The demands imposed by the transatlantic slave trade had a devastating impact on the hinterland of Benguela. This is an image that shows, is from the Atlas of the Transatlantic Slave Trade, published in 2010 by the same people who organized the Transatlantic Slave Trade Database, David Altis and David Richardson. And it shows the regions where the people who left Benguela, so more than 700,000 people, were distributed in the Americas. And you can see the high concentration in the South Atlantic. As I mentioned earlier, the port of Benguela was a major outlet for the departure of slaves in the area of the transatlantic slave trade. One problem with the estimates available at the transatlantic slave trade database is that no records are available for slave exports from Benguela before 1718. In a way, it makes sense, since there was no custom house in Benguela at that point, so there was no way captains of slave ships could pay tribute, could pay taxes over the slaves they were exporting. So it makes sense, since there was no custom house, that no documents would be available. Yet I came across several cases of slaves identified as Benguelas in the Americas. The presence of these people indicates that the number of slaves exported from Benguela might be even higher than what we know right now. So I will give you some examples. In 1615, at least two slaves identified as Benguela were in Lima, Peru. In 1625, were in Havana, Cuba. I could go on in a very long list of individual cases, but what it shows is that the early slave trade did not leave many traces in Portuguese records. But sources from the African diaspora, more precisely from the Americas, indicate that the slave trade was active in Benguela in the 17th century. Yet, since no slave exports are available, the overall estimate on the transatlantic slave trade ignored the importance of this port in the 17th century. So I searched for people identified as Benguela in Rio de Janeiro, Minas Gerais, and Bahia in Brazil, and I had the help of scholars working on Peru, Colombia, and Cuba, who identified Benguelas in local archives. My goal is not to revise the numbers, but to indicate that through the analysis of individual cases, we can see how people identified as Benguelas were in the Americas in the 17th century. They were more common than we had imagined. And it also helps to explain the threat of French, English, and Dutch traders on the coast of Benguela in the 17th century. If Benguela did not participate, or its participation was marginal in the transatlantic slave trade in the 17th century, as scholars have claimed, how can we explain the Dutch invasion of Benguela in the 1640s? Why would the Dutch invade a place that was not important? And why would French and English traders be constantly seen sailing along the coast of Benguela if this was not an important place? What I'm trying to show is that the Dutch and other Europeans, they knew that there were slaves there. They knew they could find captives of war available in Benguela. And the fact that they did not recognize the Portuguese monopoly over the slave trade doesn't mean that they were not participating in the slave trade. But because this is illegal in the eyes of the Portuguese, we do not have documents, evidence that this ever took place. More research needs to be done on the Benguela slaves in the Americas, and this is a great topic of research. If there is anyone starting the PhD, looking for topics for the PhD, we need people working on who are these Benguelas in the Americas. No one is doing that in any part of the Americas, so new topic out there. So more research needs to be done on the Benguela slaves in the Americas in order to be able to map the places where they came from in West Central Africa. And even to understand what is to be Benguela in the Americas. Is this the same than it is in Benguela? Because there is no Benguela identity in Benguela. So what it means to be Benguela in the Americas. But this example demonstrates how studies and records about Africans in the diaspora can increase our understanding about the African past. Despite the lack of documents, slaves were shipped from Benguela, probably illegally, in the 17th century. And another point I want to emphasize with this map is that the South Atlantic, in the South Atlantic, what ruled was bilateral trade. This is not a triangular trade model that applies to the North Atlantic, but is a bilateral connection. In the 17th century, the bilateral connection was between Benguela and the Spanish colonies, and you can see some links there indicating the trade to Cuba, and you cannot see, but there is Rio de la Plata, south of Brazil. And in the 18th and in the 19th century, the bilateral connection was with ports, Brazilian ports. This map shows the Portuguese presidios, or the military administrative center established in West Central Africa. So you can see Benguela here in the coast and a series of other places. And I will talk a little bit about Kakonda, this place that I showed the baptism record early on. So I will talk about this place, which is located 200 miles inland. Slavery in West Africa was also unique when compared with other regions of the continent in the sense that Portuguese agents, and here I'm including people born in the colony of Brazil. When I talk about Portuguese agents, I'm including Brazilian-born people who, for most of the period, were Portuguese subjects. But Portuguese agents actively participated in the capture of people in West Central Africa. Unlike other parts of the continent where Europeans' actions were limited to the coast, Portuguese traders and administrators were quite successful in establishing a foothold in the territory in West Central Africa. A colony was established, and raids were part of the crown policy regarding territorial occupation. Besides the nomination of a colonial bureaucracy, and here I'm talking about governor, judges, you name it, the Portuguese crown also built a fortress, a Catholic church, a chamber, and a hospital, very similar to what they have done in different parts of the world. Portuguese legislation was imposed on the population, and African rulers were forced to sign vassalage treaties, which imposed a series of obligations such as payment of tribute and adoption of Christianity. This is an image of Kakonda from mid-18th century, the place that I showed in the map before, and you can see how it is. It was a small Portuguese enclave in the interior, and what I don't know if you can identify here, but here's the house of the chef do conselho, who represents the colonial authority, the cemetery, the church, and you will see some of these places. I will show some pictures later on. And here's where the core of the fortress, where the soldiers lived. Military administrative centers such as these ones were open in the interior, some 200 miles away from the coast, such as Kakonda, with the goal of controlling the movement of long-distance trade and tax caravans carrying slaves. These centers in the interior became Portuguese spaces in the sense that people living there were considered Portuguese subjects. Colonialism was not sustained through territorial control, but over the control of subjects. In this way, since the 17th century, the Portuguese colonialism introduced new ideas and labels, such as classifying people as subjects or rebels, Catholics or heathens, whites, blacks or mulattoes, slaves or free. Although some of these ideas might have existed before, I'm not saying that the Portuguese invented slavery in this region, but some of these ideas might have existed before, they gained new meaning in the era of the transatlantic slave trade. Moreover, colonialism invented chiefs and appointed rulers allied to the Portuguese who collected taxes, reported data for census making, and in some acted as indirect rules, proving that the indirect rule is not an invention of the late 19th century. So here, as I promised, are pictures of Kakonda. This the place that you saw earlier images, and you can see the church in the main road is still standing there, and the baptism records, the document I showed before from the end of the 18th century, is from this church. And Kakonda was a Portuguese fortress founded in the end of the 17th century, and later on it was moved into a new location. It was the most important slave market in the interior of Benguela, and it was a location from where colonial armies gathered and organized expeditions further inland. Pierce records are available from this fortress since the mid-18th century, showing how colonialism had moved inland, imposing new social ideas. What is also surprising is the fact that a large number of people were captured in regions between Kakonda and the coast, even by the mid-19th century. So rather than a slaving frontier moving inland progressively and in chronological fashion, targeting people from the interior of the continent by the mid-19th century, what I see is lots of people being captured close to the coast. People who could speak some Portuguese, people who are familiarized with Portuguese colonialism, people sometimes who had been baptized. I came across dozens of cases of people kidnapped and sold to the Atlantic slavers living in regions very close to the coast. People who could present their cases in Portuguese in the colonial courts. Treaties located inland in places such as Kakonda were the main stimulus in the expansion of Portuguese colonialism inland. They helped spread the Portuguese language and values such as baptism and marriage in the Catholic Church. They also wore pants and shoes, consumed cassava, manioc, and drink cachaça, an alcohol produced by slave labor in Brazil. They also carried muskets and handguns and spread colonialism inland. Thank you. Itinerant traders who traveled inland represented the Lusophone culture with their lifestyle and became the model for people who lived miles away from the coast. It is easier to quantify the demographic impact of the transatlantic slave trade than to access the social effects of the imposition of a new diet, such as the adoption of corn and manioc, the introduction of new consumption habits, such as the demand for Brazilian-produced alcohol and Asian textiles. Evidence suggests that by the 18th century, the population living in the central highlands, so places such as Kakonda, cultivated crops from the New World. They drank cachaça produced in Brazil by slave labor. They relied on slave labor for production. They baptized the children in small Catholic chapels. And they were deeply involved in the Atlantic economy, even though they lived far away from the coast. Rather than stability and continuity, I see a profound change taking place. The transatlantic slave trade altered marriage and naming practicing, transforming eating and dressing habits, and converted merchants into political elites. The long-term effects were considerable, resulting in the emergence of an elite of enslavers and slave merchants and giving rise to regional political fragmentation. Oh, here's some more pictures from Kakonda. This is from the fortress, the barracks, where the soldiers used to stay. You saw in the previous map, the map from the 19th century. Angola has a very long history of civil war in the 20th century. So this place that suffered several renovations during the 20th century right now is completely destroyed because of the very long civil war Angola faced during the Cold War context. So this place has been completely surrounded by landmines, so it's not safe to go there, and the architecture has been destroyed, but lots of people have also died. This is the church that you saw in the previous image that you can see in the 19th century map, but also the parish records come from this church. And this is a map of the interior of Benguela in the 19th century. The main characters of this history saw themselves as subjects of the rulers of Ndombe, the one who lived along the coast, but also the ruler of Kakonda, Kilengis, Bié, or Wambo. Sometimes they also saw themselves as Portuguese subjects or Luso-Africans, as his scholars claim. I do not come across the term ovimbundo ever in any written document, and ovimbundo are the largest ethnic group in Angola in the 20th century and 21st century. The inhabitants of Benguela's hinterland were not members of the same political and social community, a fact that is essential to understanding enslavement in this region. So basically, there was no one claiming to be Ovimbundo before the mid-19th century in this region. People saw themselves as members of different political entities, but not as members of a single unity. As in other regions, only on a very few occasions, people enslaved fellow citizens. And when it happened, it was mainly due to judicial condemnations. Criminals were enslaved and banned overseas in the same way that Europeans exported their criminals into their colonies. In most cases, however, slavers captured enemies, people who spoke a different language, worshipped a different ancestor, or who had a different political allegiance. People enslaved outsiders, not fellow countrymen and women. Thus, the political fragmentation of Benguela hinterland and the absence of a unified sense of community help to explain the 300 years of involvement of the transatlantic, this region with the transatlantic slave trade. In the early 20th century, the work of missionaries and anthropologists emphasized cultural and linguistic homogeneity in this region, but the evidence indicates that this cultural unit did not result in political unity before the 20th century. In the 17th, 18th, and 19th century, the people who inhabited Benguela's hinterland lived under a variety of polities of different sizes and styles of organization. People were not seen as part of the same political or linguistic group, which explains why they raided each other. The sense of unity occurred after the end of the transatlantic slave trade and was probably shaped by the arrival of missionaries. But again, nobody has ever worked on the shape of the Ovimbundu identity, so it's again another topic, great topic of research for anyone looking for a PhD topic, work on the construction of the Ovimbundu identity. So what I'm claiming here is that the Ovimbundu and other ethnic labels familiar to any Angola or Angolan specialist are a result of a historical process that happened after the end of the transatlantic slave trade. This is Benguela nowadays. Unlike the castles in the coast of Ghana, at Elmina, or the Cape Coast, there is no remaining evidence of the fortress that once stood in Benguela and from where people were paid taxes and were exported. The fortress was destroyed in the 20th century, despite its historical importance. The only historical monument in Benguela that deals with pre-20th century events is this one, commemorating the arrival of the Portuguese explorer Manuel Cervera Pereira in 1617 and the foundation of the colony of Benguela. There is no place to remember or to acknowledge the people who were exported from this port. Although the fortress is gone, part of the past intimately related to the transatlantic slave trade can still be seen in Benguela, in the Nossa Senhora do Populo Church, from where many slaves and free people were baptized, including the people who were put on board of slave ships. They were baptized in this church before they were exported to the Americas. But there are also other, this is the interior of the church, sorry. And you can have a view from where the fortress once stood and where the church is. And you have a series of houses such as this one, the typical Portuguese sobrado, the two-story houses that are a feature of Portuguese architecture associated with colonialism. Some of these houses are still standing, and I want to believe that some of the donors, the local slave traders that I'm working on right now, and I've been writing about them, I want to believe that they live there. But there is no evidence to that, and it's a little bit of historical imagination, but I'm trying to see if I can locate where these women once lived. But regardless of the lack of monument in Benguela memorializing the slave trade and the near invisibility of Benguela in the historiography, this past should not be forgotten. Examining the slave trade at Benguela contributes to the history of slavery and the history of West Central Africa by reconstructing the experience of the affected population in an effort to understand the complexity of political, social, and economic transformations imposed by the transatlantic slave trade. Benguela is not an exception. Like the changes that affected Senegambia or southern Africa, Benguela and its hinterland was a region deeply transformed by the Atlantic economy. Rather than marginal, the institution of slavery is central to understand the history of this region. I could go on for hours on this topic, but I think it would be better if I stop now and I can answer some questions that you might have. Thank you.
Arguments, and I'm wondering who he, presumably he's arguing the same way. So what is this, what is the argument exactly about it being marginal or not? Like, why is that worth taking on, first of all? And then I was very curious when you mentioned the damas, the women who were doing this, and you were talking about, you know, the food and the dress and the baptism, and I'm wondering about the impact on gender relations, mm-hmm. since that seems to be, it seems also the women were trading. Okay.
Should I take several questions? Okay. Joseph Miller. Joseph Miller is one of the fathers of, second generation of founders of African history. And he has written extensively of West Central Africa. His work is almost mandatory for anyone interested in Angola. And it's part of a very long debate that starts in the 60s with Walter Rodney on the impact of the transatlantic slave, and it goes even earlier than that, but in the impact of the transatlantic slave trade over African societies. So there is a group of scholars who claim that the transatlantic slave trade had a devastating impact, and others who claim that no, that African societies, African economies were strong enough that they were able to overcome any demographic loss or any economic impact that the exporting so many people might have had in this. You can see where I stand in the debate.
They are
middle grounds, but I'm trying to summarize a very long debate. There are many people. There are people who have been writing about this for 40 years. It's a hot topic. It's a heat debate. It gets very personal in some levels. But Joseph Miller claims that slavery has a marginal role in the formation of on the consolidation of the Portuguese Empire as well. He's comparing with the British Empire, where slavery is seen as the center. I'm talking about a debate in the 90s that has also been revisited since. But in the early 90s, that slavery is seen as the foundational factor for the economic boom of the British Empire. And what Miller is trying to understand is why, if slavery is important in the British Empire, why was it not important in the Portuguese one? So he claims that even though slavery existed, the Portuguese dominated the slave trade, the Portuguese never managed to accumulate the wealth that the British did. It's a very long debate. His book is 700 pages, so it's even difficult to summarize these in 30 seconds. The donas were the merchants, the local women who participate in the slave trade. They existed everywhere in the coast of Africa. They are not unique to Benguela. Lots of people have written extensively on the donas. There is a very good work done on women who work as intermediaries. And this is what I'm moving. My new project is on women, on how gender relations change in the 19th century. So what happens when it goes from a slave export economy to a slaving, an economy based on slave-produced labor locally, and how the power of women shift in this process. Most of the women, most of the slave trades in Benguela were men, but because of how trade works, they had to marry with local women, and Portuguese men tend to have a very short lifespan in Benguela. So there are some women, I was able to find women who are married more than five times, and they keep accumulating wealth after each one of their partners died.
Yeah, that's similar to a lot.
Yes.
Just like they justify their actions. Would you equate their agenda with the Third Reich? They're like the master, like pseudo Christianity. It's okay to make slaves. You see the connection there?
Sorry, I don't think I heard.
Hitler claimed they were the master race, so they had rights to make slaves. Was that the Portuguese and Dutch English? Was that their rationale for stealing people? Anybody ever come up with a theological, spiritual reason why they had the right to make slaves?
Okay.
Like it was a pro-choice thing, you know what I mean? You know, Aristotle? Yeah, because, it says laziness ends in slave labor, but that doesn't mean make slaves either. The Bible condemns slave trading. So I guess it's one of those situations. It's like Hitler claimed that they had a right to make slaves. He said, I do not hesitate to call the whole world our slaves. So I guess that was the pro-choice rationale in the African leaders. They said, we have a right over your body. So I guess...
All right, thank you.
The theological justification, there was theological justification. No, initially it's religion-based. The whole idea behind the Portuguese expansion, one of the ideas behind the Portuguese expansion, is that the Portuguese had expelled Jews and Muslims from the territories, so it was okay to occupy North Africa and keep expelling Jews and Muslims from these territories and expanding Christianity. And they had the full support of the Vatican in this enterprise. And the logic was that they could conquer people who were not Christians and convert them. So they were doing a favor in this logic to people that they were expanding Christianity and bringing people into the light of Catholicism. Of course, there are lots of people who were who converted to Catholicism in West Central Africa, and this becomes a problem when people are Christians. Then you cannot enslave them according to this logic. And it goes in a very long change on how you're going to justify. It moves from a religion aspect then to try to find other explanations. Yes?
I have a question about the project of the 1680s and 1690s of the Portuguese to build a road from Luanda, from Angola to Mozambique. I was surprised at how far inland Kakonda is. Do you know how much it costs to maintain that fort? Are there budgets? Are there ways of estimating what the expense was? Because one of the issues about the construction of the road was the cost of defending it, and I was really surprised to see how far inland Kakonda is.
Mm-hmm. I am sure there are information about the cost in the archives, and I must confess that I did not pay attention to that. It's my fault. Another topic. Somebody has to look for this information. And the Portuguese were very vigilant on how much they're expanding and so on. But one thing that I want to emphasize is at the largest moment of Portuguese population in Kakonda, there were 14 Portuguese men in Kakonda. So this is a Portuguese space where very few Portuguese men are living there and no Portuguese women. So this is a place where descendants of Portuguese, let's say the children of Portuguese men born in Benguela were sent to occupy this place. They identify themselves as Portuguese, which is one of the challenges with the sources that sometimes, now in the qualitative sources, I get many more Portuguese men than I get in the census. So there is this imbalance of how can it be that in the census there is only 14 men and there are 100 men claiming to be Portuguese in order. It has to do with how people could identify as Portuguese or not. That is certainly not the way we would identify people today as Portuguese. But Kakonda is part of the project of reaching to the coast of Mozambique. They did not manage to go through Kakonda. They changed the route later on. But Kakonda is seen in the 17th century as a way to connect to the coast of East Africa. Of course, the Portuguese thought that the territories were closer than they really are, which is interesting because they keep thinking that they are getting close to the East Coast when they were far away. But it's a great question on the cost. Sorry, I cannot answer. Yes.
Going back to the idea of the vassal agreements with Portugal, you mentioned, I think, earlier in that it was kind of a way for elites of these communities to kind of get, you know, at least have a reason as to why they shouldn't be enslaved. Or at least maybe that's what I heard. Do these vassal agreements ever, like, extend to other classes, or was it just generally kind of like an elites versus Portugal kind of thing?
The vassalage treaty is a Portuguese, is a medieval Portuguese institution that was applied in Portugal before, and it was applied in other parts of the coast of Africa as well. It was used in Brazil at the same time. This is the treaty signed with the local population of Brazil. And it's when people recognize that they are subjects of the Portuguese crown, and it creates a series of rights. So the question is, did people sign vassalage treaties because it would bring advantage to them? I assume that the problem with the sources is that we only have one side of the story. So we do not know what African rulers thought about the occasion. Perhaps some rulers, and I assume that some rulers signed the vassalage treaties thinking in terms of political survival. They can have access to weapons. Why not to sign a vassalage treaty? In the long term, it created a series of problems. And there were several cases where the Portuguese crown intervened, the governor appointed by Portugal removed a ruler and put in another one who were allied with the Portuguese because they thought the vassal was not good enough for Portuguese standards. But it also is interesting because it creates a series of misunderstandings. There are a series of topics that have to be followed when you sign a vassalage treaty. And so vassals, for example, the ruler of Kakonda, one of the states, he signed a vassalage treaty in the end of the 17th century. He receives the weapons. He's quite happy when he gets the weapons. Then the governor wants slaves, the tribute that he's expecting. And the ruler of Kakonda doesn't want to pay, and he says, I'm not a vassal anymore. So he creates this, and the Portuguese crown cannot understand what is going on, because you cannot sign a vassalage treaty and say that you are not a vassal anymore. Now, if you got the weapons, you have to provide the slaves. So there is a very long, interesting battle between the two forces, where the Portuguese, basically, the governor in charge of the mission says that he is going to teach the people of Kakonda who is in charge here. It's a very interesting document that talks about, you know, gender relations, masculinity, the relationship of how Portuguese saw African men, and so on. But there is a lot of misunderstanding, and the problem is that we only have one side of the story. We do not know the other side. Yes.
Yes, Angola received its independence in the 1970s after the bitter civil war against the Portuguese. To date, have any black Angolans written about this particular period that you're talking about?
No. No. Angola, since this, the war in Angola started in 1961. In 75, they got independence. And from 75 to 2002, they were involved in a proxy war, no, Cold War conflict. There, the country was devastated. The infrastructure was devastated. Lots of people died. They still don't know how many people were lost in the Civil War. So for 40 years, the country was in a chaotic situation, and people were not really concerned about, you know, thinking about the past. And even nowadays, the major question in Angola is how to build this country rather than thinking too much about the past. And the past that involved slavery is usually a past that people don't want to talk about. People want to forget. Better to forget topics that are not, you know, will not unified and might create division in the country, so people are not willing to talk about slavery. There are lots of Angola historians writing about the history of Angola, but more recent episodes, the colonial period, 20th century colonial period, or the moment after independence, after 75. But they aren't, one of the problems in Angola, they aren't enough Angolans interested in history and writing about the history of this region, which is, it's a problem because they have all the documents there. Yes.
Yes. I have a question about the landscape of the place. You can go back to that image. If I understood correctly, it's a contemporary image. It's an image from the 17th century?
No, it's from the 19th. It's a map from the 19th century.
Okay, all right. I misunderstood you. I just wanted perhaps to pursue a tiny bit more the question of the documentation, the visual documentation of the space, and how will you interpret that particular way of representing Bengala, particularly in connection to your claim that this area has been kind of like made invisible, not within a particular kind of like geography of the Atlantic slave trade, and how does that image connect to other kind of visualizations of places of the slave trade in the 17th and 19th century? I would be grateful if you can talk about that.
You were talking about this map or
the
picture? This one?
No, the landscape of the Bengala.
Sorry. It's slow.
Okay.
This one?
The next one. Right, and also if you can also talk a tiny bit about the context of this, I mean, what was the functionality of this image and how it relates to your claims of invisibility?
This image is from the coast. It's from the ocean facing the town of Benguela. There is a little bit of recreation because there are mountains, but the mountains are not so close. So there is also a little bit of artistic insight here on how to make it look nicer than it is. What you can see here is the two churches. One church that at that point had been completely abandoned by the Portuguese, and they were the second church, or this church here, is the church that I saw a picture later on of Nossa Senhora do Popolo. And what you can see here is the walls of the fortress that are gone, but that helps, for example, to... One of my difficulties in walking in Benguela, in not having, for example, a specialist on urban history of this region, is simply to place the to find the places, to be able to put in the geography, to find what these documents talk about when they refer to land, for example, where was the house of so-and-so. The streets have changed their names and we don't have... There is a gap in the history of Benguela in terms of the history of the port. It's like in the history of the port. This image is by Nogueira da Silva in Alceato. It's from the National the Archivo Histórico Ultramarino in Lisbon. But there are two dates for this image, is one of the problems. One is from 1862 and one is from 1878. So it's not even clear. This image was reproduced twice. So this is a color one, but it was also published in a newspaper in that circulated in Benguela in the end of the 19th century. So there are different dates. One where this was, I would assume that the first one, 1861, if the image is there, no, it's probably the first one. And the image doesn't change except the color. But some of the sobrados that you can see in this image are still some of the sobrados that we can see on the coast when you are facing from the beach. You can see, but the mountains are not there. But it gives a sense. I like this image. It gives a sense of how the place was small. It's certainly what is missing from this image, and what interests me most is where the local population, the Ndombe population who lived in this region, where they are here. They are invisible here. No, this is simply a colonial town where Portuguese lived. But when you get to the census or to other documents, you see that the Portuguese were the minority in this place. Of course, there are local people living in these houses, the so-called Portuguese houses we see here. But on the nominal list that are available, there is a large population living in so-called senzalas, which is an interesting term, because senzalas in this context is the population living around the colonial urban perimeter. And in Brazil, senzala is the place where it's the slave quarters. So it's a term that traveled the Atlantic and got a different meaning. So the senzalas are missing in this image. And the people. And the boats. Many things. Okay, yes.
I was just wondering, you were saying the Benguela, if you're trying to identify people from the area, where are you trying to do that, through language, or are you trying to do it through verbal history, or what? Somebody would have to identify themselves? How would you?
Well, in the Americas, in the
Americas, yeah, what do you know?
In the Americas, I basically worked with documents from the 17th century, so parish records more than anything, and court cases. And it's surprising how parish records is always a debate. If people are really Benguela, how one decides if this is a Benguela or Angola and so on. But then I came across three cases, Inquisition records, where people came forward and say, I am João Benguela, I am from Benguela, my parents are from Ndombe, or in specific places in the interior of Angola, where they clearly claim to be Benguela, which is way more interesting when people say that in front of a judge in the Inquisition than a parish record that simply, we don't know if it's the slave owner who is saying this person is from Benguela, and the person never being Benguela. Because maybe registering someone as Benguela would give you a better price or a lower price in the Americas. Okay, Emily, can you help me? Okay, go. Please.
So you mentioned that you've learned a lot about Benguela through the analysis of individual cases in Colombia, Peru, Brazil. And I'm just curious as to know if there are any more instances of that in other regions of the world, say Asia, or just anywhere in general.
I haven't came across them in my research, but I never looked for them. Somebody has to look for people. But for example, in Benguela, there are people from Goa, part of the Portuguese circulating empire. There are doctors coming from Goa. So if there are doctors coming from Goa, why wouldn't people leave from Benguela to go to Goa? Somebody has to look for them. Yes?
Can you say a little bit more about the percentage of the people that were coming from the coast versus inland, and whether or not that may have affected the two areas differently? What percentage of the slaves were captured near the coast versus further inland, and do you think that percentage may have affected the coast differently than further inland?
Good. I don't have precise numbers, one, because the difficulty is when people were exported, from when people were put on board of a slave ship, there was very few recollections of where people are coming from. There are some instances, but it didn't happen always. And usually we don't know how people were captured, which is interesting. In some cases, we do have the information. So, for example, people captured along the coast, they tend to be kidnapped or betrayed by someone they knew. And there are several cases like that. There is one case, just to give you an idea. There is one woman who is from Benguela, or who is from Kakonda, and her mother sends her to Benguela. So she lives from the interior to the coast, and she's in the house of someone her family trusted. And she was going to learn how to be a seamstress, believing that that was a good skill to have in a poor town. She was living there for several years until one night the husband of the woman from Benguela, cannot remember her name, but then the name of the person from Kakonda is Quitéria. So the husband of the lady from Benguela decided to kidnap Quitéria, the young woman living in Benguela, and sell her to a slave trader. This was a free woman. Her family had sent her to a person who was supposed to protect her. thinking that it was a safe situation. But the husband of Maria from Benguela didn't know, thought that he could get quick money. Who knows what was going on? He needed, he had a debt. We don't know his side of the story. The fact is that he sold this young woman to a transatlantic slave trader. She very quickly was branded, as it was practice. She was branded and put on board of a slave ship. When Maria returned home, she didn't find Quiteria. She found her husband. They had a physical encounter. No, there was fight. She was hurt by her husband. And she told he told her he had sold her protege to a transatlantic slave trade. She went crazy. She went to knock at the house of the judge in Benguela. It's a small town, so everybody probably knew each other. And she couldn't get her protege to be free unless she offered another person as a slave. So she went to the slave market. She bought another person. She freed Quiteria. So Quiteria does have a happy end. She's freed. But the other person, who remained without a name in the document, was sold on the place of Quiteria. So we can see these kind of cases of freedom being restored, but it's being restored for some people. It means that other people were simply losing any opportunity to be protected because they were seen as legal slaves in the Portuguese colonial document. But I do not have the numbers of people coming from the interior. In the interior, warfare is usually the mechanism through which people are captured, men and children. This region of West Central Africa had a large number, is one of the largest number of children exported from any part in the African continent comes from Benguela. Yes? These were like 15 questions. I will try to answer all of them. Who lived in Benguela? Some Portuguese lived in Benguela. Some people coming from Brazil lived in Benguela. Many people coming from Brazil lived in Benguela, including some Brazilian women and some black Brazilian women, which is interesting, and I want to follow these women, but I don't have much information about them right now. But the largest number of people living in Benguela were local population. They were so-called Ndombe. This is how they are called by the Portuguese. They are called Ndombe. Ndombe is an ethnic group. It's recognized as an ethnic group in the 20th century. They moved away. They used to be on the coast, but they moved inland. The Ndombe are not, by the late 19th century, they are not on the coast anymore, showing how people migrated, but also how ideas of a state migrated inland because of the Atlantic pressure. Who is writing these documents? This is great. There is a combination of people writing these documents. They are Portuguese officers coming from Portugal, different parts of Portugal. They are people coming from Brazil, some of them Portuguese, they are descendants of Portuguese, some are not, coming from Brazil and writing these documents in Portuguese, but most of the documents are produced by local people. They are written in Portuguese, so if you want to classify them, they are Portuguese documents. They are Portuguese colonial documents. They are produced for the colonial empire, for the Portuguese empire. They are counting people. They are registering people. But even, for example, the priests who are baptizing people in Kakonda in the interior, he's not born in Portugal, he's born in Luanda. So he's what we would call nowadays an Angolan. There was no Angolan at that point, but he was from Luanda and he was traveling inland baptizing. He was preaching in the interior of Benguela. So the sources are produced by a variety of people. They tend to be in Portuguese, although depending on the place, for example, documents produced in Kakonda tend to have lots of Umbundu terms, local terms incorporated into the documents. Some of them, if you're reading nowadays, it's very difficult even to understand the Portuguese they are written on, showing that people not necessarily had the same writing skill that someone coming from Lisbon might have of Portuguese. Sometimes I have to read the documents aloud to understand the Portuguese that is written, which is interesting because it gives some hints about the people producing these documents. So you can claim that these documents are Portuguese at the same time that you can claim these documents are Africans because they are producing by people who are born and living in the continent, even if they are in an European language, such as Portuguese. I think this is about who lived in Benguela and the documents. I got the identity, who is claiming to be. The people claiming to be Benguela, the cases that I mentioned before, Inquisition records, they are in the Americas. People claiming to be Benguela. In Benguela, no one is claiming to be Benguela until 1850s. And this becomes a problem because supposedly, according to the whole literature on the transatlantic slave trade, Benguela is a port, it's not an identity. So people become Benguela when they are, let's say, exported to the port of Benguela. And in the Americas, Benguela becomes a way of remembering a place where, doesn't mean where they came from, but it's the last place that probably they were in the continent before they arrived in the Americas. Okay, but then what should I do with people who in 1846 are saying in documents in Benguela, I am João Benguela and I marry Maria Benguela, which is exactly the same kind of name construction we see in the Americas. So this is a case also to be explored on how, or this is one of the social changes that I'm seeing associated with the transatlantic slave trade, is a new identity emerging in West Central Africa, which is Benguela, which did not exist before. People who are from the town, the 17th century were called Ndombe. By the 19th century, they are called Benguela. So there is a new identity. In terms of other social changes, it has to do also with how it changes marriage practices, for example. Suddenly you have a new group of attractive, prospective husbands for women who are these men who come from abroad and they don't live long. They bring imported commodities that you want. You want to have textiles, you want to have alcohol, you want to have beads, and they don't live long. So why not to marry them? And some women marry them several times. I'm not saying that they didn't love them. It's very difficult to know if people love each other when you only have a marriage record. Who knows? But the fact is that marriage changed in the sense that locally born women were marrying in the church, something that did not exist before the Portuguese arrived. They were marrying more than once, and they were bringing their children to be baptized, which I think is more interesting. Even people living inland were bringing their children to be baptized in the church. The question is, why are they bringing their children to be baptized in the church?
How did you get married twice in the church?
Like, if they die. It's a widow.
It's a widow, but can't do this, of course.
No. Exactly.
Yes. Yeah. A widow, you can do as many as you want. Yes, please.
Oh. You mentioned that that Brazilian women would come to Benguela, and I was just wondering how common is voluntary migration between Benguela and Brazil?
Voluntary migration of men was common. It was seen as a business opportunity, is a place to make money. There are lots of people who left Brazil for temporary, short periods of time. Some relocated, But it also was a strategy of the Portuguese Empire to send criminals overseas. So people who committed crimes in Portugal or in Brazil or in Goa or in Mozambique or in any other part of the Portuguese Empire, one of the most horrible places to be was Benguela because of the short lifespan. But Brazilian women is not so common. There were some Brazilian women, but somehow we know that they left Brazil, but they get lost. I do not know if they arrive in Benguela or if they died, no, because crossing the Atlantic was not an easy enterprise. But I found a case of one, and this is the case that I want to find more information about, one Brazilian woman from Minas Gerais in the interior of Brazil. She's a black woman, and she traveled alone, and she died in Benguela after 3 weeks. And in her burial records, there is lots of information on her husband. She's married in Brazil. Her husband stayed in Brazil. She has children. She has grown up as sons who are well-placed in the Portuguese Empire. So the question is, like, why is she doing in Benguela if the only business in town is slave trade? What is this woman from Brazil traveling alone? It's a black woman from Brazil. I cannot imagine that this is an easy trip. What is she doing there? I do not know. She didn't write anything.
All right, one last question.
Yeah, I'm wondering if your documents also tell us about slavery within Benguela and how the transatlantic slave trade may have changed the use of slaves, and who was a slave, and what are the same people who were transported from the transatlantic slave trade?
The documents do refer to slavery in Benguela a lot. They do not refer much to slavery inland, in areas that the Portuguese don't have access. So this is one of the difficulties, to understand how slavery changed in the interior, in places where the Portuguese were not. But slavery in Benguela, who can be enslaved in Benguela? Anyone who can, who is not Ndombe. So Ndombe people are protected from slavery in Benguela. They can be people coming from further inland, so regions like Kakonda. These are usually people captured in what is the Portuguese called just war, so going back to the theological justification of slavery. So people captured in just war, this is captives of war. These are enemies of the Portuguese crown, and they can be slaves in Benguela. Slaves in Benguela did what slaves did everywhere in the Atlantic world. They did all the hard work. The food production, the cleaning, the construction of these buildings, they were done by slave labor. They run the ports, they load and unload slave ships. They carry people, they carry the Portuguese inland. They also help to transport people from inland in the caravans coming to the port, so they do all the work. We do, the population in Benguela, the slave population in Benguela usually is not born in Benguela, but there is a growing number of the so-called Benguela slaves in the 19th century. And some are called Criollo de Benguela, indicating these people are in the same way that Criollo is used in Brazil, that these are people who have been familiarized with Portuguese. They were born inside of Portuguese households, probably. So these are people who you may want to call acculturated. I don't know if that would be the correct term to use, but people who were exposed to Portuguese culture and colonialism in this region.
Was their status lifetime, and did it transfer to their children?
No, it is very similar to slavery in other parts of the Atlantic world and in the Americas. It is for good, and unless you can be manumitted. There is a high level of manumission in Benguela, as in other parts of the Portuguese Empire, because men, Portuguese men, tend to manumit the children they have with slave women. It doesn't mean that it always happens, but they tend to manumit and recognize the children. What else can I say about them? The largest number of people enslaved in Benguela were women throughout the period. How slavery changes, it becomes more widespread the more time we have. And we have more information on the kind of economic activities they were engaged in the 18th, in 19th century, rather than in the 17th century.
All right. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yes, you're right.